was first because of that idea. Two things go wrong when that happens, really. It was power, because God controlled the use of man and to accomplish his, that is, God's will. And it was purposeful, because God was determined to more visible to the nation and glorify his own name among the nations. We saw the name of God in self-identification in verse 2 of this chapter. God says, I am the Lord. He says that twice. And we saw that phrase, I am the Lord, occurs 163 times in 161 verses in the Old Testament. It always occurs in the context of one of four different contexts. Number one, when God makes a promise. Number two, when God declares his might, his will, and his power. Number three, when he gives a man. And number four, when he gives a prohibition. And we look at quite a number of illustrations of that. Just as in the book of Exodus, we found that phrase, I am the Lord, is found when God receives the Abrahamic covenant with Abraham. We'll be talking about that some today in Genesis chapter 15. And then when God speaks to Jacob in Jacob's vision of the ladder of heaven, that happened in Genesis 15. And then we find it again the first time in Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 through 3, with the original covenant with Abraham. We also look at that phrase, thus saith the Lord. And we discover that it occurs 415 times, 413 verses in the Old Testament. Because God is making a promise based upon his name, concerning the name of his name, it's extremely important in the Old Testament. He uses it to confirm his covenants. He uses it to confirm his promises. He uses it to guarantee judgment coming. He uses it to guarantee that if you disobey him, something bad will happen. When God is heard by his name, as we saw, or makes an oath, or a covenant based on his own name, it is because there is nothing greater by which he can swear. Hebrews chapter 6 makes that very clear, that by two immutable things in which it was impossible for God to lie, and we saw it in that context, his name, and his character were the two immutable things, we might have a strong consolation who have fled up for refuge to lay hold on the hope set before us. And so when we look at the name of God, which he declares himself here in our text, the name God, Jehovah, it's not a matter of head knowledge. It's not a matter of, I haven't heard the name before, because as we saw the name God, or Lord, in all capitals, it's found 159 times in Genesis alone, long before the events of Exodus. In fact, it first occurs in Genesis chapter 2 in the creation account. So clearly, Moses and the children of Israel had heard the name God before. That this is the God who had created heaven and earth, the God who spoke with Adam, the God who made a covenant with Abraham. Knowing God by his name means to personally know him and to experience his awesome working power in your life on your behalf, not merely knowing about God. We saw that knowing God is personal and intimate. It's the same word that's used in the miracle law, established by our first physical relations between man and woman. And that's the way Jesus of Adam and Eve and at the divine moment time in their bond is established as only broken by death. And we look at both instances of that usage in the book of Genesis in that context where so alluded by Jesus seeing and there. The truth of what forms the divine marriage bond is that it broke only at death, as it broke by Christ, and it's true that the church is as well, because it's rebroken in the doctrine of wisdom, the book of Satan's Matthew 19, Mark chapter 8, verse 56, and Ephesians chapter 5, verse 31. We saw that in the next thing. When a man marries a woman, the woman takes on the man's name. From then on, she is going to be publicly and only identified by his name. The same is true for us as Christians. We are only and publicly identified by the name of Christ. Acts 11:26. And when he found them, he bargained with them and God, and the king passed the whole year they assembled themselves with the church of all the people. And the disciples were first called Christians in Antioch. And that word called her, interesting word, only occurs a couple of times in the New Testament. It means given a name based on your chief occupation. That's the same word that's used by the Apostle Paul when he says that the woman who divorces and marries will be given the name she shall be called, the relatives, it's that same word she shall be called, given the name based upon her chief occupation. The disciples were first called, given the name based upon their chief occupation. Christians first, and now We saw verse 36:18, flee fornication. Ever since a man loses his other body, he can live fornication simply against his own body. 2 Timothy 2:22, flee also with your lust, all righteousness, and charity, peace, with them that call on the Lord out of a pure heart. And there may be a whole bunch of words that is sort of rhyme with each other, but remember, flee, don't flirt. Flee, don't fight. Flee, don't friendly. Flee, don't fall. Flee, don't find out. Flee, don't follow. Flee means not to fear your moral nature. Flee means life, the service of God, by any fast, run away as fast as hard as you can. Fornication, lust, will kill you. It'll ruin your life, it'll cloud your conscience, and drag you down to the baggage that you'll carry for the rest of your life. And this is all by you, you're not able to fully, willingly, unashamed marriage that you should have done with other people. This is a bad carefully. Keep yourself pure. Let me look at a whole series of passages. But let me test you. Trust us to be pure. I think we saw 10 different passages all together that we looked at last week. If you keep fornication, you keep lust, you will never have to worry that someone will find out what you're getting, will never have to lie out at night wondering if some other person or that person told somebody else and posted up what he or she did to you. You will never have to wonder if people are talking about you behind your back, or certainly what they know, or looking at you on the side of the night because they think out your moral purity. Flee, the scripture says. Flee, flee. That's related to knowing God by his name, but covenant name. Because he is divine marriage covenant name that God places upon his people. That's what we call everything means when we enter into the full union with him. That's why the man who anticipated heaven is called the marriage peace of the Lamb in Revelation chapter 19. God calls you to know him. God calls you to know him. By name, you take his name upon yourself. Knowing theology is different than knowing God. Knowing God is different than knowing God. The devil knows God, but it's not an intimate personal relationship with God. And that brings us to our study for today, to look at verses 4, 5, and 6 in Exodus chapter 6. And I have also established my covenant with them. Speaking to those who are the descendants of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, which he just mentioned in the preceding verse, I have established my covenant with them to give them the land of Canaan, the land of their pilgrimage where Canaan was created. So, in other words, the covenant that we're beginning with this passage here is a land covenant, what's been called a Palestinian covenant, because it relates to a particular piece of real estate that God has set aside for national Israel. Verse 5, I have also heard the groaning of the children of Israel, whom the Egyptians keep in bondage, and it is again, and I remember my covenant. In other words, this covenant has been stated before. That takes us back to the Abrahamic covenant, which we'll look at in a few moments. Wherefore say to the children of Israel, I am the Lord, and I bring you out from the burdens of the Egyptians, and I will reach out of their bondage, and I will redeem when they stretch out their arm into the great judgment. That was takes place as God sent them from Egypt at the cross of the Red Sea and formed them into the national entity at that point. Now there are 9 specifically stated covenants between God and man. They're stated that way in the Old Testament. And that's not really God promises to the church in the New Testament, because in the Old Testament, the church is ministry. You've heard me preach on that before. Paul says that the ministry is something not revealed in the Old Testament, but not revealed in the Gospel of God. By the Spirit, Ephesians chapter 3. The two covenants, the covenant of works and the covenant of grace, is not introduced in the Christian theology. The covenant of days of Romanus Pontius, who lived from 1603 to 1669, more than 100 years after Martin Luther nailed his 95 theses to the church door of Wittenberg, Germany, beginning the Reformation. The 9 covenants are specifically stated in the scripture to be covenant between God and man are number 1, the Edenic covenant, that has a covenant meaning condition, unfallen man's life, it has 7 parts, I'm not going to look at that today. Number 2, the Adamic covenant, that's condition, fallen man's life, I want to stay outside of it. It also has 7 parts. The Noahic fifth covenant is the Mosaic covenant that's taken for us in Exodus chapter 19, verse 5, which is what we're giving of the law at Mount Sinai. It is known as the law. It is a conditional covenant. There are conditional covenants. There are unconditional covenants. It's a conditional covenant as opposed to an unconditional covenant. An unconditional covenant depends entirely on God and cannot and will not ever be broken. When God makes a covenant where he bases upon himself, it is a covenant that is guaranteed forever. It will be, in fact, accomplished. It cannot be broken. A conditional covenant can be broken by a man who is only consequence, and we see that happening in wisdom over and over and over again. When they broke the law, God chases them. They broke the law, God chases them. They broke the law, God chases them. We see the cycle of judgment, the book of judgment over and over and over and over, many of the book of judgment ends. Every man got his right in his own eyes. And God judges them, he chases them, he called them oppressors. And when they repent and return to him, then he restores his blessing to them. That's conditional. God specifically states that the conditional covenant of the law is broken by Israel. He states that in Jeremiah 31:32 and Amos 39. Now, Mosaic covenant number 5 is specific to the national Israel, not the church. The Mosaic covenant governed the national Israel as a redeemed people. However, it was not given to them as a means of redemption. Very important to remember. Nobody ever could be or ever would be saved by the meaning of the law. It was not given as a means of salvation or redemption. You see, redemption had already occurred at the cross of the Red Sea. We saw that in verse 6 of the text today. Exodus 6, verse 7, the children of Israel, I am the Lord. I will bring you out from under the burden of the Egyptians. I will bring you out of the bondage. I will redeem you with the stretched out arm from the great judgments. And then Noah was fulfilled when God reached the cross of the Red Sea around here where all the horses and chariots didn't bring any of the Red Sea. And then Israel came up on our land. God being the man of Egypt. So the Mosaic covenant, which came after, was not a means of redemption. Rather, it was to give the children that they were in a right relationship with the God who made the covenant with their physical ancestors, Abraham. We find a number of very important things stated about the Mosaic covenant in the New Testament. Number one, the Mosaic covenant is proof that man cannot save himself. Number two, the Mosaic covenant is proof that all men are lost sinners. It only condemns, it does not justify, it only condemns, it proves that you are lost. Number three, the Mosaic covenant reflects the holiness of God, who has an absolute standard of righteousness. He is holy, he is pure, there is nothing defiled in him. Number four, the Mosaic covenant shows that man cannot attain to the righteousness of God alone. If we could have been saved by the people of all, we would not have been Calvary. The Mosaic covenant shows that man cannot attain to the righteousness of God alone. Number six, the Mosaic covenant is neither a means of salvation, nor is it a means of sanctification. You say, well, I'm saved by grace through faith in Christ, I should have been on the cross, but now I'm going to keep the law to make myself sanctified. No. You are sanctified by faith in Christ Jesus. That is very easy to get lost to all in Acts chapter 20. Number seven, the church is not under the Mosaic covenant of the law. That is specifically stated in the scriptures that I give you from Matthew. John 1:17, the law is written by Moses, but the grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. Romans 6:14. For sin shall not have dominion over you, for ye are not under the law, but under grace. Listen, you will never make, you will spend your entire life giving yourself to death and never get anything. Romans 7:4, brethren, ye also become dead to the law by the body of Christ, that ye should be married to another being to him who is raised from the dead, and we should bring more fruit unto God. We talk about that in the marriage relationship and the names of God last week. Verse 5, for when we were in the flesh, the motions of sin, which were by the law, connect the law of flesh. It beats you to death. It does not save you. It does not sanctify you. Which were by the law that we work in our members to bring forth fruit unto death. The law condemns. It does not justify. liberty, and some of them go to change on both sides. We are bound to direction. We are delivered from the law, but we can get it where we are held, that God might change, that we should serve in the newness of the Spirit, not in the oldness of the letter. You can't do it anymore. You can try all day long, and you will violate the law. 2 Corinthians 3:6. Who also makes a mention of the New Testament, not of the letter, but of the Spirit, for the letter killeth, but the Spirit giveth life. And we'll pick up a theme there, we're going to talk about that in a moment. Verse 7. But if the ministration of death, written and engraved in stone, as the tablets of the law, is glorious, so that the children of Israel not sit back in the whole face of Moses, but the glory of his countenance, which glory was to be done away. Did you get that? Which glory was to be done away? How shall the ministration of the Spirit be rather glorious? For if the ministration of condemnation, that's the law, if the ministration of condemnation is glory, much more if the ministration of righteousness is seen in glory. Righteousness by faith in Christ alone. For even God, who is made glorious, had no glory in this respect, by reason of the glory in itself, none of which we compare it to, was the law glorious? Yes. Moses had a veil of space. So the children of Israel see glory and glory in their face. Law was glory consistent. Yes. So if the other glory is going to compare with the glory of the Holy Spirit is doing in your life, your faith in Christ. Had no glory in this respect by reason of the glory in itself. For if God, which is done away with glorious, much more than which remaineth is glorious. See that we have such hope, we use great plainness of speech, and not as those who put a veil over their face, that the children of Israel would not set fast the book and can of that which is abolished. But their minds were blinded. For I shall say, I'm reading the same veil on the way of reading the Old Testament, which veil is done away in Christ. But even unto this day, when Moses is read, the veil is upon our hearts. I've been in Israel for a year, my wife has been in Israel for 2 years. We had so many opportunities, and wonderful opportunities, to sit down for hours at a time with Jewish young people. Some have been gone for rabbinic school, and this is a rabbinic created to quote massive portions of the Old Testament in Hebrew. And as we discussed, we quote various passages. And if I remember a woman man who I have prayed for now almost 40 years, who said, Christians are so wonderful, but when you say that Jesus is God, we quote Shlomo Zalman, you're always with the Lord our God. May God have freedom. Here, pray for Barak and Jane, his wife, their children. You know them on that account. Know them at all, crying. Judy and I were over for our meeting. She took the wicked kingdom for us on holiday. Wicked kingdom on holiday. That's what they had. And we sat and talked for many hours, way back to tonight. And I shared passages of the Old Testament, the children of Jesus, the Messiah. But he came and he fulfilled the law. And he offered his life. Not only to the obedience of the law, but through faith in him. And I sat there with tears dripping down my face. And as we got up to leave, we knew that we'd be passing. It's a whole bus. Closed down by that, you can go over your back, and I'll sign over there. He says, I'll be here. I'm not here to make a decision. Either you will trust Jesus as your Messiah, or you the divine light for until it's saved, for made the same veil and take away the weeping of the Old Testament veil to the way of Christ. These are your friends who still have a veil in their hearts. Nevertheless, when it shall turn to the Lord, by the their hearts shall turn to the Lord, the veil shall be taken away. Now the Lord is that Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. We all know that we see the old and is of the last, the glory of the Lord, our shame into the same image from glory to glory, even by the Spirit of the Lord, not by keeping the law. The Spirit of the Lord will change you from glory to glory. Galatians chapter 3. But before we came, we were kept under the law, shut up under the faith which should afterward be revealed. Wherefore the law was our schoolmaster to bring us under Christ, that we might not be justified by faith. But after faith is come, we are no longer under a schoolmaster. I don't think you've been under the passages. The law is a schoolmaster to lead us to Christ, not a standard of living in the church. Our standard is Christ, not the law. Our empowerment is the Holy Spirit, not the flesh. You saw the many places where the flesh is an enemy of the law, and it works for a first sin. It may be a subtle difference, or so it seems, but the difference in actually living the Christian life is huge. What motivates you? What empowers you? What gives you the strength and the joy and the peace? It is not law keeping. You see, living in the Spirit by faith keeps you from sin. Living in the Spirit by faith makes you humble. It doesn't make you proud. You check the law better than the next guy. Living in the Spirit by faith avoids you to extremes of legalism and lasciviousness. Living in the Spirit, I have given you joy, and now I'm rich in hardness in the Spirit. I have been living around people who are rich and hard in their spirit. They do not have the joy of Christ. Your people, this is a serious difference. That's the fifth covenant, the Mosaic covenant of the law. The sixth is one that we're trying to deal with today, and that's why I'm in this. We'll learn the next year. It's by our that any that is considered the covenant that relates to the land, in light of our conflict that's happening in Israel, that we have a mosque today. I have to hear from the military, people from the military, call up from my duty, and I don't know whether they're safe or not. But I'm just tasked by the living in Israel, you know, for 4 years. Then the church is going to shut up. And for another 3 years, learn all about vertical diseases that are in the United States, but which now are seen through our borders, and no other doctors are ready or prepared to meet that crisis at his time. His master, God of man, the word of Jesus, very good God, say the other church of Christ, that one was. Now they're serving God faithfully for many, many years, the land of Israel, and the many Jews of Christ. God said to the church, they have 4 children who are living on the last day. Prayer. The best man. The parents are praying. The children now are dead. And there was a joy. Evan, who's been in Bible school in England, Paul, which means to do what he comes out and pick up all the grass. And their friends, many of them have left Christ, and they were Christians. Very bad. How was the meaning of them? Deuteronomy 31, 14. I'll just summarize it for you. Read the passage we have behind. This covenant gives conditions upon which national entities will enter into the promised land, and the conditions necessary that they remain everlasting possession is akin when he gives his covenant. God guaranteed when they were still on the land and they're chasing after their sin, that God would hold the land in escrow for them, and then he would shoot them at a particular time and bring them back to the land. God guaranteed that he would bring them back because Jehovah's covenant with Israel cannot grow peace to such an extent as that. But the Palestinian government also has set up the words to look at what he currently learned in 3rd book of 14. Let me just read that covenant for you. I've got 2 minutes here. Let me just read it. We'll be together next week. Deuteronomy chapter 3. As a covenant who has all these sins come upon me, blessed be the curse, which I have set before thee. And thou shalt call unto mind all the nations which the Lord thy God hath given thee. So if you can lose some of the blessings of the nation, you get thrown out, pull back in, get thrown out, pull back in. That's a major thing as far as you know what we hear from the centuries. And shall occur that the Lord thy God shall obey his voice according to all that I command thee this day, thou and thy children, with all thy heart, with all thy soul. But then the Lord thy God will turn thy captivity, and have compassion on thee, and have returned the captivity from all the nations, but with the Lord thy God has scattered thee. If any of thine be driven out from the heavens or from heaven, from thence will the Lord thy God gather them, and from thence will he cast thee. And the Lord thy God will bring thee into the land which thy God has possessed, and thou shalt possess it, and it will do thee good and multiply thee with all thy fathers. And the Lord thy God will circumcise thy heart, and the heart of thy seed, to love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, that thou mayest live. And the Lord thy God will put all these curses on thy enemies, and on them that hate thee, which persecute thee, and thou shalt return, and obey the voice of the Lord, and keep all his commandments which I command thee this day. And the Lord thy God, this is the intro, which I have over here. It's all capital R-E, almost a different Christian. And the Lord thy God, will make thee plenteous in every work of thy hand, in the fruit of thy body, and in the fruit of thy cattle, and in the fruit of thy land, for good, for the Lord will make thee rejoice with thee for good, as he rejoices with thy fathers. If thou shalt hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God, and keep his commandments, and his statutes, which are written in this book of the law, and if thou turn unto the Lord thy God with all thy heart, soul. For this command which I command thee this day, it is not to be from thee, neither is it far off. It is not a man that thou shalt say, you shall go up to heaven, and have your living place over here, and do it. Neither is it beyond the sea, thou shalt say, you shall go over the sea for us, and have your living place over here, and do it. The word is very nice in thy mouth and in thy heart, but thou mayest do it. That's the statement of the American government. There are three other governments that have been coming, but that's the second thing. The life of the national Israel of thousands of reigning Christ on earth, Jeremiah 25 verses 31 and 32, and then the new covenant. It's a heavenly covenant for heavenly people, and all the churches now revealed in the Old Testament we have been brought into the benefits of this covenant at Pentecost. National Israel will be brought into the benefits of that covenant during the millennial reign of Christ. Well, that's roaring through the covenants. And once you understand that God has made many covenants, many promises, some of them are conditional, some of them are unconditional, and we're going to talk about and try to detail for you what's going on in our text in Ephesians chapter 6. Excuse me, Ephesians chapter 6 next week. Praise your heavenly Father, we thank you again for your word, for your power, for your great and mighty precious promises. The covenants that you have made, you are covenant making and a covenant keeping God. Now we praise you and thank you for that. And Father, we pray that you will help us to understand the great and precious promises that you've made to us, and also the great and precious promises that you've made to Israel as a national people. And Father, we pray for peace in Jerusalem. But I pray for my dear friends, whom I've prayed for 40 years. Draw them to Christ. Oh, Father, they have your word. Cause them to trust in the Messiah, but they only get in the way of their hearts. Protect them in this hour of war and distress. Against evil, Gracious Father, show yourself strong with your hand. Glorify